Welcome back to True Believers and the Road to Hell. We're here with Kim Chavez-Cook, who has graciously agreed to share her views with us. And Kim, thanks again for being with us. It's really interesting hearing your perspective, and you have a very intelligent perspective that I don't always like, but but it's probably right. No, I appreciate you being here. We were talking about all of the things that need to be done in order to, what, you know, the two of us probably are pretty much agreement on many of these things. So what's the problem? You know, that what if we're so convinced that this is so right and this would be a much better way to, much better way to proceed as a society, as a community, as a system, then why in the hell can't we get this done?
Well, I think because for obviously a lot of reasons. One is just the maybe most simple of this is the way we've always done it, and just change is hard. I think that there is I think it's also very difficult and very rare for people on the other side of the system impacted by the crime itself to want to or be interested in a, you know, restorative justice model or whatever you want to call it. There is a, humans are vengeful, I guess is the simplest way of saying it. People feel like if you have hurt me, I want you to suffer. That's a very natural and very psychologically normal way to feel. And DAs are going to prosecutors are always going to feel like they should be guided by the interests of the victim or the desires of the victim. So if the victim says, no, I don't want you to, you know, go easy on this person, I want them to suffer, then the DA is going to, in many cases, they're not bound by that. They don't have to do what they're saying, but they oftentimes feel that it's part of their job to represent those interests and go into sentencing asking for the max. So there's the human component of it that makes it very challenging to then change the system, because if we go into the legislature and say, let's rework corrections and make it completely different, then, you know, there's a whole other sort of cohort of people that are going to come to the legislature and advocate for the opposite result. So those are all just the practical barriers, you know, we can show decision makers how well this has worked in Norway. You know, or whatever, we can do that all day long. But then the fact that those decisions are made by political bodies in our system means that they always have to answer to the voters, and they have to answer to the media, and they have to answer to, you know, all of those are our barriers. So I don't know that I honestly, as much as I said I was hopeful about properly funding and staffing the public defender, maybe within the next generation, I don't know that I actually feel hopeful that my dream of the correctional system would ever come to fruition in America. I don't know that America has the will for it.
Well, that's such a letdown from because because just
we
minutes
left off at the break with like, we're going to fix it.
Right. Well, and no, just in part one of when we started our conversation, I mean, we started off with your Pollyannish self, I guess, or the optimist. I didn't mean that as a pejorative.
I know what you mean.
In the glass half full type of
coming out.
The pragmatist and this and that. And now you're saying, gosh, you don't have hope that that's really going to happen. But so, you know, I think you would agree. And I want to talk to you about, I'd like to segue this into your political work, because there is obviously, I would think, you tell me if I'm wrong, I would think there's a real eye-opening effect about doing the real strict technical, legal, argue the Constitution, argue the statute work, and then going over to the legislature and trying to change that statute or change that law or that procedure or whatever. And the different dynamics are just I guess at one time somebody, I'll give you a little story. Somebody was saying, as a lawyer, well, why doesn't the political system, you know, my God, you know, they didn't even hear me out on this, or they, but I didn't get the opportunity to give them this information, or it didn't seem fair what they were, how they were making this decision or whatever. And I said, well, you know, comparing the political system to the court system, it's like comparing the rules of chess to the rules of cage fighting, you know, because it's, I mean, it's just two different dynamics. I think you would agree with that. So I'm wondering how your eyes were opened on that, in that dynamic.
Sure. No, I think that's absolutely right. I think that you don't have due process in the legislature, right? You don't have the right to be heard in a legislative hearing. The our legislature in New Mexico is actually, I think, particularly good about including public comment and things like that. There are sometimes challenges in, you know, depending on the issue, depending on the day, depending on the time in the session, how much time people get varies, but they're pretty good about making sure that people at least get to get up and say something, right? That being said, I guess what jumps out at me is one of those sort of facing reality moments was the first couple of years that I was doing this.
Doing what?
The legislative work. This was 2013, I want to say, was the first session I did. And the NMCDLA lobbyist at the time was Susan Hamilton. And she was sort of showing me the ropes. We were sitting in a committee hearing. We'd already given our public comment and had sat back down, and now it was the committee debate that was happening. And one of the members said something that was just completely wrong, described how things are done. I don't even remember what it was. It was some statement of what happens in a criminal case that was just completely wrong. And I tried to raise my hand, and Susan grabbed my hand and put it back down. And she leaned over and she said, I don't even remember what the exact words she said were, but it was something to the effect of like, your time is done. Now you just like watch the ship sail, and that's all you can do. And it was so hard to get comfortable with that. And I have found myself sort of showing other attorneys the ropes over the years and having to give them sort of a similar message of like, no, you cannot stand up and say objection, Madam Chair.
But what effect has that had on you though? I mean, seriously, there is a real dichotomy. I mean, there's a very sharp contrast between the work you do over arguing something before the Supreme Court, which you've done and done in a grand manner. And yet you go over to someone who has no legal training whatsoever, or who is well-intentioned. I'm not saying that they're bad people necessarily, yeah, or anything. Just
or as an attorney who just doesn't do criminal work, which is
right.
The other thing.
All right.
Run into.
Yeah. But I mean, it's just a total different, it's a fish out of water type of thing, mm-hmm. but there's totally, totally different environments. Mm-hmm. And so how does that affect you? You know?
Yeah, you develop different skills. So it either affects you by, you say, throwing up your hands and being like, I hate this process and I don't want to do it anymore. And you quit and you let somebody else take the reins. Or you learn how to navigate this different system. You stop trying to use your courtroom skills in a not courtroom setting and you learn different tools. So, you know, for example, nowadays, what I would do in that same situation where I wanted to stand up and say, nuh-uh, that's not what happens, is I scan the panel of members of the committee for someone who I know well enough that I maybe have their number in my phone, and I will text them a message saying, hey, that thing that was just said isn't accurate. Here's the actually accurate thing. And then they jump into the debate and say, you know, I actually want to clarify or whatever. So I've used that tool many times. Or you assess, does this committee vote really matter? Am I trying to kill a bill and I'm just not going to be able to kill it here and I can kill it in the next committee? In which case you just make your peace with them getting it wrong in this committee and then you hit the bill in the next committee. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. The
No, no, that's
I,
okay.
I've had a similar experience when I was testifying before a committee and some legislator was making some point that was pretty... well, was wrong. And mm-hmm. so I've you know, I started to politely say something, but the sponsor at the time just kind of nudges me and says, forget it, we got the votes, just count the people, just count the people in the room, you know. I mean, it's a purely a numbers game at that point or whatever. So you and I have both had, you know, we're talking about being able to change the system politically. And I don't want to just beat our head against the wall here, but the let's take an issue that I think you and I would agree generally on, and that is mandatory minimum sentences. Mandatory minimum sentences, in my view, are one of the biggest obstructions and cause the most disparity in the system. New Mexico does not have the worst, by the way, minimum mandatory sentences, but generally speaking, just the concept distorts the system, in my view, and you and I have had, I think, had the discussion about that. The truth of the matter is, we can get just about every legislator, not everyone, but just about every legislator in New Mexico, we can probably get them to agree to that. I mean, they probably agree, understand and agree, many of them do. Many on the, let's say, the blue side, especially, right, agree, and yet trying to get something, a law passed on that issue is like the third rail or something. It's like attaching yourself to a lightning rod, right? So I think, would you agree that that's an example of the difficulties of the political system?
Yeah, I think that's where you run into sort of the consequence of democracy, which is that politicians are beholden to their voters. So they can't always vote their conscience if they want to keep their jobs. And so there's that. And I think there's the fact that voters in general are not very well informed about the criminal legal system. They learn mostly through fictional television what the system looks like. And that reinforces people's predisposition to thinking that defendants are bad guys, always, and irredeemable and all of that stuff. And that police officers are always honest and forthright and, you know, out to save society and keep us all safe and all of those things that are sometimes true, but not always true. So yeah, I think with mandatory minimums is a good example of an area where I think we can get most of the blue votes, so long as there is not then a strong presence. And again, this is where it really matters, like the level of participation from the sort of victims of crime perspective, who are sometimes have, and so this is a lot to unpack just in and of itself, but what does that even look like? There's multiple schools of thought within the sort of victims of crime themselves. First of all, most criminal defendants were victims of crime at some point in their lives. Also, there are definitely many quote unquote victims who have taken on the mission of reform because they don't think the system is serving anyone. I remember when we were opposing the death penalty, we had family members of people who had been murdered and whose killer had been facing the death penalty and who were opposed to the death penalty because they didn't think that, you know, eye for an eye was gonna do anybody any good. But there is another subset that falls into the more sort of like, I think the only way I will feel better is to see this person severely suffering. Punished.
Yeah.
And that is those are the people who will express serious concern to legislators about doing away with mandatory minimums because their fear is that someone is going to hurt them or someone they love and then not be punished at all.
Well, their fear is about judges. I mean, their fear is that there's going to be some bleeding heart judge that's going to, you know, let some violent person run around on the street or something. And,
right.
Which, of course, is you and I know.
Very rare. Very rare for judges to just go real easy.
Yeah, just say, okay, fine, you're free to go.
There's that. And then there's also, that's when we had our bill last year that was just addressing the mandatory habitual offender enhancements. my go-to line in every committee hearing was, we need to trust our judges. We need to trust our judges. We need to trust, you know, I just couldn't say it enough.
I know you can't say it enough, but you can't say it enough because they don't. And so no matter how many times you say it, I think it comes back to that. It's at some point. But so where are you, rather than talking the weeds so much, I mean, just where do you think the line is drawn? Or I guess I'm trying to get a sense of what is more important to you? Is it more important to you to have the legal issue decided correctly or to have the social issue?
I mean, I think the one is in service to the other. So when the way I think about the legal issues that I litigate on appeal is, and this is not always true because the laws are written by humans again, but that we should make sure that the laws are being applied in a way that maintains a sort of a social justice, that they're written that way because they have constitutional underpinnings they have to comport with, they have to provide due process, there has to be equal protection and all of that. So if we trust that the law represents those underlying fairness principles, then we need to make sure that we're enforcing those laws correctly in furtherance of those things. But even then, you have all of these issues that the law can't address, really. I mean, the criminal law certainly can't address. And, you know, in that way, I feel like I have chosen the role that I've chosen in a larger set of actors who are trying to make the world a better place, and that this is where my strengths lie, and that other people's strengths lie in community organizing and reentry for people coming out of prison and getting them on their feet, and behavioral health services and treatment, and, you know, all of those social workers. Like, we need it all. We need all of those people to be working.
Let me challenge you a little bit on it, in that you're absolutely right, of course, but in terms of your decisions, you have, on the one hand, I mean, you can tell I'm somewhat fascinated by this contrast between you going over to the arguing the Supreme Court about paragraph B3.2 of a particular statute,
sure,
and why that should matter, and then going over in the afternoon to the legislature and talking about eliminating, you know, repealing the death penalty or something. I mean, those are just contrasting approaches. If you had, and you're not going to have to choose, but if you had to choose, which would you think is the more?
Oh, I see. Now that I understand the call of your question, the answer is easy. If I had to choose, I would choose the legal Supreme Court argument path.
Because you think it sustains over time.
It sustains over time. It satisfies more of my, because I, again, and maybe this is circling back to something I said earlier, I am driven in my work. I mean, I could retire today if I didn't have clients. So I am ultimately every day getting out of bed and doing the work because I have clients who I know their names, I know their mothers. I don't have clients at the legislature. I talk about clients as examples of injustices I've seen or problems in the law that they need to fix or whatever. But the work, that the advocacy for a particular human person has always been the reason I do my job. So I couldn't give that part up to be an advocate in a general way, I don't think.
That's really interesting. That's very interesting. Because, for one thing, because I had intended to ask you two questions. One was, what drives you? And the other is, what keeps you up at night? And mm-hmm. you just answered that question in one. You just answered both those questions in one statement.
I think I think the other thing that I really love about the litigation work that you don't get at the legislature is, first of all, the legislature is more about, I don't know. I mean, there's the politics of it, right? Which is not my favorite thing. I can play that game in with an end goal in mind, but there's something more pure, and again, acknowledging that all the actors are humans and sometimes it's not this pure, but there's something pure about arguing the law to judges who are actually trying to get to the right answer, and you make the best intellectual and legal based, you know, based in principle, supported by authority. It's like a math problem. Like you feel like you can get to a right answer.
We've always had, I think, or at least it's important to me, very important, that we keep in mind the individualization of these cases, of the, of each case. Each case is an, as you say, is an individual who has his or her own whatever history and whatever issues and so forth. And the legal issues are individual as well. And too many times we try to paint with a broad brush. Mm-hmm. So, but, so I totally take you for what you're saying. I just think that is so admirable. I really respect you for that. Let me put another.
Can I add one more thought to that before I move on to the next thing? I'm thinking about an oral argument that I just had last week at the Supreme Court that was sort of a perfect example of that. Where at the legislature, I feel like I'm talking at legislators. I'm trying to tell them something about the law to persuade them to do something that really is guided by their gut and their voters' will. At the Supreme Court, I am helping them to understand something so that they can ultimately just see it completely from my perspective, I guess, is like I'm trying to convince them to agree with me. I don't need legislators to necessarily agree with me about what the law is or whatever. It's very hard to articulate, but this oral argument I had last week was a very active back and forth exchange trying to get at, okay, what is the right answer here? And there is a right answer that they need to articulate in an opinion. And there was a legitimate and sort of on equal footing in terms of we both come at it with the same basic knowledge about the law, which is not always true at the legislature. And where I feel oftentimes like I'm having to like explain myself more than I'd like to. And we're just trying to like find out, okay, so what is the right answer here? And I feel more free in that environment than I do when I'm at the legislature where I have to sort of watch what I say, try not to offend anybody. You know, I mean, there's just...
You don't try to offend Supreme Court justices, do you?
I think it's harder to offend them, frankly. I don't think that the things that I'm... Because I'm making legal arguments to them, it's
and
like there's not as
and
much...
And you're biased because you've got a client, yeah.
And I mean, and they recognize that, right? They recognize that I'm an advocate. So if they disagree with me, they're not going to be like, how dare you say such a thing? I mean, they have before. I'm not saying that they wouldn't ever say that, but they're less likely to sort of be offended by my taking that position and more inclined to just say like, okay, we appreciate that you're advocating for your client. You can go sit down now.
Let me push another.
Yeah, go ahead.
Scenario then, and because... As I said, I think it's very it's remarkable and it's very admirable of you that you have the position you do. I really respect it. Let me just twist it a little bit, though, to say that, yes, I've argued for many clients in courtrooms over the years, and you argue for that client, and you hope you get a good feeling at the end of it for having a favorable result or whatever. On the other hand, at the legislature, and this is also true of the rules committees, by the way, that you can do things that will affect thousands of clients. That if you are successful, if you have a, of course, it works both ways, right? I mean, there's bad legislation that affects thousands of people, right? And we'd fight that. But if you are able to get a piece of affirmative legislation passed, even a word changed or whatever, you might have actually helped thousands, sure, tens of thousands of people over time. So I guess from that perspective, you could argue at least that I'm not trying to get you to change your mind.
Sure.
You know what
I'm
saying?
And I always have in the back of my mind that my legislative advocacy is ultimately in service to all potential future public defender clients, right? Or not public defense, just criminal defense
people, community members. Yeah, sure.
Sure, absolutely. Of course. And that improving the law just benefits society. It's not like there's no, it's not like I'm not advocating on behalf of something bigger than myself at the legislature. There's just something that drives me when there's an individual client whose case is directly affected as well. And that, you know, appellate work, we change the law as well. So I do get to retain that piece. If I have to choose under your hypothetical, then, you know, I do get to keep that piece of it by doing appellate work.
Okay. But, well, I'm not trying to get you to change your mind.
No, and you won't.
But, I knew that too.
But yeah, no, I mean, it's a good point that that there is, and that is one of the reasons why I really do enjoy the legislative work, is because of that potential for fixing it. And there are things we cannot fix through the courts. You know, we can't get them to write. I mean, occasionally you can get them to read in something into a statute that isn't there because it's so obviously implied, but you can't get them to affirmatively change a statute even when it's poorly designed. If there's a problem with the statute, the court is going to apply the statute as the legislature intended, or as they can infer the legislature to have intended it. And at that point, if you want it to change, you've got to go to the legislature. So I do enjoy being able to come at it from both angles, through both branches of government. But
well, we both agree that I think that we have what I call this. I don't know, it seemed like a detriment or pejorative to me, is we have what we call incremental progress, you know, which is
and compromise.
Well, compromise, which you're always asked to do. And the public defenders in particular are always asked to wait till next year, you know, because they recognize the need, but blah, 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 you know, you've heard it before. Mm-hmm. So incrementalism is something that's... It's not my favorite. It's not my favorite dynamic. Let's put it that way.
Sure.
I'm going to change the subject on you, if you don't mind. And I'd like to ask you what your experience is as a woman in the New Mexico. Well, in New Mexico, but in particular in the justice system. And I'm wondering about. I guess that's all I need to ask.
Sure. So, I mean, I think that I don't feel like I can speak on behalf of other women on this issue very well, partly because I have a tendency to sort of forget that I am a woman in the gender dynamics. I'm not like conscious of it most of the time. I don't know why that is. I think it's always sort of been true for me. It's not, I never, as a kid, when I hear people talking about the sort of dynamics, and, you know, I'm sure I've been mansplained to plenty of times. I don't notice it half the time. I just push back on it immediately, and I don't identify it as a gender thing. I see it when it's happening to other people. I don't see it when it's happening to me. I was never shy about raising my hand in school. I was, you know, that annoying girl who answered all the questions in the law school class. I didn't ever feel conscious of, you know, having any, I don't know, limitation or lack of respect because of gender. I am super lucky in that regard, because I know that other people experience it and are very conscious of it. And it can be, you know, limiting. It can be psychologically limiting and then actually create barriers to success. What I will say is that I have, in my time at the LOPD, made more connections with other women who were doing something similar to me, that to what I was doing, and been sort of self-educating through my relationships with them, and becoming more conscious and cognizant, and really pushing myself to do the whole, you know, reach out and pull people up behind you kind of approach. Because I never really had a like team woman, team man perspective. And I still don't have that, but I do see the need for women to lift each other up. And so I actively try to do that. So I think that's what, if I've had an arc, it's that. But like in law school, most of my circle of law school friends were men. And it never really occurred to me that that was weird or that I was the only woman or anything like that. It was just, that was my circle of friends. And so I didn't have a lot of those conversations until I started working at the public defender. And the appellate division has always had a fairly high percentage of female attorneys. And so I just, that's been a recent journey for me, I guess.
Well, I hear you saying that, my impression of what you're saying is that you're just incredibly stable and confident, and you are obviously quite successful. I'm wondering, from your vantage point, how you see the arc of this in New Mexico over the last 10 years, or are we making progress? Are we going in the wrong direction? Are we overplaying this or that issue? I'm just wondering how you see it.
Sure. I think that we have a very strong female lawyer presence in New Mexico. All of the sort of like professional events that I've attended have included a lot of leadership by female attorneys. There's a lot of women who are, you know, leading the various bar organizations and organizing, and a lot of our district defenders in New Mexico are women. A lot of the people who are volunteering to be on rule committees. I chaired the UJI committee for a number of years, and it had a pretty high percentage of women on the committee. Our courts right now, our appellate courts in particular, are majority female. So are we making progress? I mean, I think that all seems to suggest we certainly are doing pretty well. The governor, since I became a lawyer in New Mexico, has always been a woman, for better or worse, with, you know, in terms of their particular ideologies. But you know, we have strong female leadership in the government and in the legal communities of New Mexico.
Clients treated, I wonder, in that respect? I mean, are there, do you have more or less, you have more or fewer women clients, or are there more or fewer women in the system, which I guess some would argue that, and I'm not arguing for this, but I argue mm-hmm. that there should be more women in the system, because why should they commit as many crimes as men, blah, 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 blah. They don't. But you know what I mean. I mean, in terms of its proportionate numbers and this and that.
I'm no expert in the data side of this, but the last time, having sat on a committee of the Sentencing Commission for the last few years, the last time I heard the numbers on that, New Mexico actually has per capita sort of a high number of women in prison. It certainly is a small percentage of my own caseload, and the types of offenses that women are charged with tend to be, you know, fewer violent crimes, more sort of drug or drug adjacent crimes, property crimes in furtherance of drug crime or whatever. And a lot of times seem to, in the fact patterns that I see, be women who essentially, and I hate to overgeneralize this way, but sort of get caught up in their boyfriend's criminal scheme. And so for whatever that's worth, I mean, I do think that I think women are represented accurately, maybe. I don't know if that's the word for it, in terms of being a smaller percentage. I think that's correct. I mean, I do think that for
whatever, are there more women being imprisoned? Then that's my sense. I don't know the numbers either, but are there more women being actually incarcerated than there used to be?
That's my recollection from the last time I was looking at the numbers the Sentencing Commission keeps, is that the female population had gone up notably in the last few years.
Why is that?
That's a great question. I mean, they break it down by type of crime. I know that drug crimes are a big piece of that. And I suspect, and I can't prove it because the data doesn't exist, nobody's keeping the data accurately enough for me to prove this, but I suspect that a lot of it is because judges are having to give habitual time. I think this is my hypothesis, and I challenge someone who has access to data that can generate this. It's not anywhere. I've asked the Sentencing Commission for the data, and they said nobody keeps it. I am suspecting that women who are being categorized in their report as being in on quote unquote drug offenses are serving just the mandatory habitual time for drug offenses and not even serving basic sentences, and that judges are more inclined to suspend sentences for female defendants, but can't when they have habitual mandatory time. That's my gut feeling from what I've looked at.
But it makes sense in terms of why they would be incarcerated, but I'm not sure it explains why they would be more incarcerated today than 10 years ago.
Enforcement, I don't know. Or it's possible that that cases are actually going up, that we have a sort of substance use crisis going on in the state of New Mexico. That's a real thing.
I thought maybe, and again, I'm just hypothesizing too, I just thought maybe there was some social pressure on it in terms of reverse equality, you know, treating women in the system.
Hard to say. I haven't seen anything that has like made me think that, but I wouldn't rule it out. I have no idea. I mean, that would be something that would sort of happen in maybe even subconsciously in a judge's mind that I would never know about. So I'm not sure.
Well, it raises an issue of one thing that I see all the time is especially in, you see a sentence, for example, there's a lot of Trumpster related sentences, and there was a Derek Chauvin case. So there's various sentences where white males in particular have been sentenced, and then
you sort of send a message of we're going to punish you too.
This message, right? Mm-hmm. I hate that term, send a message, but the mm-hmm. it's a real thing. But I hear the argument many times that gosh, you know, this, if this were a black person, he would have gotten double the time or whatever, which undoubtedly is a true statement. That historically, mm-hmm. But by my way of thinking, wait a minute, we're not arguing that there's too little prison time. We're arguing that
you should treat everybody the way you're treating the white guy.
That's right. It's not. Right. Yeah, it's like everybody should have the OJ defense. Not that nobody should have the OJ defense. Right. Or everybody right. should be. Yeah, everybody should right. be treated like the white guy was. And the black people should be treated equally to the white person,
right?
Not that we try to increase penalties on everybody else. That exactly. just makes this, that makes everything just that much worse. Am I making any sense here?
Yes, no, I completely agree. I think the last time I was having this conversation, it was more in the context of Black Lives Matter. And it's not that we're saying that we want the police to shoot the white suspect too.
Right.
We want exactly. them to not shoot anybody.
That's right. There you go. Right. Okay. That's a better, very much clearer example. Exactly.
But same logic. We want judges to be more sort of rehabilitation oriented and more community rehabilitation oriented than prison oriented for everyone, not just the white guy on the swimming team who's going to lose his.
That's right. I bet it, instead of being, you know, I think like I get accused of being an apologist for white guys or something. I don't know. It just mm-hmm. anyway, you got my point. So
and
that seems to me to be a real concern, especially in your political work. In talking to a lot of very, very inexperienced legislators who are very well-intended, who have perhaps liberal views on this and that. Whoops, there's your phone.
Sorry, that's you're my good. That's calendar your, reminding that's, me to do something.
I'm sorry. I hope we're not interfering. But let's see, what was I saying? I don't know what I was
inexperienced
saying.
Legislators.
No, these legislators are very, very well intended, but they want to take it out on, you know, want to equalize things in the wrong direction. I guess we're right. saying the same thing over again. But that seems to be what I was saying was that that really is a real problem of narrative when you talk right. to legislators that. So anyway, so what do you yeah. think that, you know, I'm obviously a white guy and I've had the advantages or benefits of the patriarchy over the years, you know, and women have been, especially women of color, have been mistreated for since the beginning of time. And what are your views about what people should do and what people, especially like me, should do to try to put this in the right direction?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a, you know, like I said, I sort of came late to the party with this because it's not like I wasn't cognizant of gender discrimination growing up. I just, my reaction to it was always just complete and utter resistance. And that's a personality thing. And that came naturally to me, and I didn't have to like muster anything to be that way.
But you've seen a lot of others who aren't as strong as you.
Right. And it's not even not as strong, right? It's maybe just, I mean, like, frankly, I'm sort of aggressive. Like, that's not, it's not always a good quality to have. I think it's a quality that plays in a patriarchal setting. It's like I'm speaking the language of men because I'm very assertive and I don't back down. And I, you know, I don't, for whatever it is, like I wear the hat of the patriarchy to get by in the system more easily than most women probably do. And so what I would say that women like me and men who benefit from the patriarchy, what we can all do is to change our own perception of what it is when there is, you know, a woman who perhaps isn't going to be as assertive, but has just as much to contribute to the conversation, is to create the space for that to happen without them having to fight their way into the conversation. And that's, again, in that what I was describing as like my recent sort of arc in this area, that is one of the things that I really strive to do. I sit in a meeting with, you know, 15 attorneys, and I try to very carefully look for what are subtle signals maybe from some people, and sometimes also men who are just not particularly assertive men, where they want to say something and they maybe barely inch forward in their seat, but then when the conversation moves past them, they just give up. And so I try to be very actively looking for those moments and shut everybody down and ask that person, you look like you have something you want to add. What is it that you want to add? And I think having that awareness and recognizing that not every, you know, useful contribution is going to land on our laps, and the need to sort of facilitate and reach out and engage people who are not, I don't know, who are not naturally inclined to say, hey, everybody, listen to me. I think that would go a long way.
Well, obviously it's not an issue that's going to be solved in one conversation, but
certainly not. And that's like one tiny little, you know, piece of all of the various pieces that need to be there.
Right. Well, you're obviously big on body language. It's very good. It's less effective on Zoom, you know,
than a lot during oral argument too.
than in that room you're talking about. But no, but it's, I don't know. I'm not the right guy to be, you know, to be making proclamations about it. Of course, it's an obvious prominent issue in our society and in our legal system, and how in among lawyers, among judges, among clients, among staff, among, you know, entity, all kinds of different groups. It's a very obviously a very big issue. And I, you know, I'm, well, I've already said who I am, but I'm a violator. You know, I've certainly violated the standards. I'm a sinner, if you will, over the years. And so trying to make good. And try so that the system works properly. Mm-hmm. But let me ask you, like these are small issues or something, and I know they're not. But what is your viewpoint of racial issues in New Mexico from your perspective? I mean, wonder what you probably have a better sense of the ethnicity issues from your perspective than gender, perhaps.
Yeah, maybe, although I don't know. Again, I didn't grow up in New Mexico. My family is from here. My parents left and raised my sister and I elsewhere, and then we all came back. So I didn't have a strong sense of Hispanic identity until later in life.
Tell us about that. Tell us about your Hispanic identity, if you don't mind.
Oh, sure. So my dad is French Canadian and, you know, British, mix of various British lineage. And then my mother's family has been here in New Mexico forever. So the Chavez in my name is my mom's maiden name. My mom's maiden name is Chavez, her mom's maiden name is Garcia, her mom's maiden name is Cervantes. I mean, we go way back.
Is that all in New Mexico?
All in New Mexico. Wow. Mm-hmm. We were land grant family once upon a time, all that stuff. My great grandfather owned the general store in Martinez Town, Albuquerque, shortly after the turn of the century, fought in World War I and came back and opened up a general store. Went to the Manal School. His family had a ranch out near Grants. And so, you know, deep roots, deep Hispanic roots in New Mexico on my mom's side. And then my parents met at UNM and moved to Denver, where my dad got his first real job out of college. And that's where my sister and I were born. We moved all over after that
You were born in Denver? Is that what you said? Okay.
Yeah. We lived abroad for a little while. I mean, just lots of moving around in my early childhood. And then, we all ended up back in New Mexico at various points after that. But where I primarily grew up at ages where I would have had been developing a sense of self and identity was the suburbs of St. Louis, Missouri, where there was not much of a Hispanic culture to be represented. I didn't really have a sense of it. We came to New Mexico every summer and for Christmases sometimes and stuff to visit family. But I, you know, didn't really see myself as any different from any of the other white kids in my suburban neighborhood. And in fact, related mostly to my Jewish friends. So it was not your classic New Mexico sort of cultural upbringing. But then in college, when I started to ask about these things, I realized that that was something that interested me. And I ended up being a Hispanic studies major in college. And that's when I sort of got up to speed on all of what that meant.
What does it mean to you today?
I mean, that's a really great question. And I don't know that I have an answer that is like true for anybody else. I think it means a connectedness to a larger population, a connectedness to basically everything south of the border. And I don't know, it makes you feel like part of a family, I guess. That's as much as I can put it into simple terms. That's as much of it as I get, is there's a, oh, hey, you and I, we have a thing that we share. That's as much of it as I think I can probably lay claim to. I speak Spanish now, but I learned it in school. I can't claim to have been raised bilingual or have had really a bicultural home to a major degree. except for the fact that, you know, my mom raised us with a lot of sort of New Mexico quirks that I didn't know that's what they were at the time.
That's interesting. What I'm wondering, how have you been discriminated against?
I don't think I probably have. Frankly, I'm half white. I'm white presenting. I don't think that up until I came back to New Mexico in my early 20s, that most of the people, frankly, in the Midwest where I was, even would have considered that I wasn't just a white girl. I just blended in. So I don't think I experienced that directly. My mom has, certainly. She's, more obviously Hispanic than I am.
I'm sorry, Kim. Yeah. Thinking about I've seen quite a bit about, I think recently, in fact, about job applications and studies being done with people who've applied for jobs who have, and I think this was from African Americans.
Sure, it's like a name that's clearly ethnic in its appearance, yeah, or whatever.
Right,
sure.
And so you've seen it where the people get a call back, the people who have the ethnic name, they don't get the call back, and the others as much
as identical resumes. Yeah.
Exactly, that kind of thing. And I'm just wondering, I am happy to hear that. I'm sorry, I just asked a question with a presumption, which is that mm-hmm. you've been had some form of discrimination. If you don't feel it, then I think that's wonderful.
Yeah, I mean,
I bet you've seen it among others for sure.
Of course. I mean, I certainly think that having the name Chavez doesn't hurt you in New Mexico, that's for sure. And before then, you know, before I was back in New Mexico, I was a teenager and a college student. And so there wasn't really, I wasn't like, my ambition was limited at the time. I wasn't applying for big corporate jobs or anything like that. So I think I just, you know, I managed to sort of avoid that. It's not to say that it couldn't have happened to me if I'd walked a different path.
Do you see it as a big issue in New Mexico?
I think yes. I think the irony what I see in New Mexico, and the sort of maybe getting back to where I was originally, where my mind was at in answering this question. First of all, I think that New Mexico has a very serious problem of discrimination against Black people. I think it's, you know, we see ourselves as tricultural, we're Native Hispanic, and we're Anglo. And sort of having had now an influx of a Black community into New Mexico, I think our cultural identity doesn't really know how to grapple with that, and we have not done a good job. I think also the other problem that we experience within the Hispanic community of New Mexico is this sort of, you know, there's the old school New Mexico Hispanic families like mine who have been here for so long that now we're just New Mexicans, and that there is a lack of comfort with more recent immigrants, Hispanics in New Mexico. That's obviously not true for everyone. I'm making a generalization, but I do think that we as a state tend to forget that we're not that different, and that this was Mexico until recently, and that many of the people who think of themselves as just purely New Mexican here have more of a connectedness to our neighbors from across the border who come here than we're maybe comfortable forging that in that connection. So I think there's a huge community of people in New Mexico who are forging those relationships and who are trying to break those barriers down and promote inclusiveness and all of those things. But I think it's pretty deep-seated in our state identity that Hispanic means, you know, like here since the beginning, and somehow excludes more recent immigrants. And so I think that is also an issue we struggle with. And then don't get me started on the Native communities being excluded and shut out of the table at every turn. So no, I mean, are we, do we have work to do? Of course we do. Yeah.
I was going to say, I mean, we don't mention the natives are just, I mean, that's a whole seminar or a whole, you know, it's a much huger issue, obviously. It's an issue all its own, the treatment of natives over the centuries has been.
And in a state like ours that is so substantially made up of Native American communities, it's pretty shameful.
It's embarrassing, yes.
We have, what, 3 Native legislators or something like that now since Senator Pinto passed? I mean, it's just, it's...
No, I understand.
It's a national shame that we wear as a country, but in a state like ours where we should know better, we should do better.
Well, let me ask you about not just Natives, but others. We, of course, where New Mexico is unique in that it's a majority minority population, mm-hmm. right? So that's a different dynamic, I suppose, and I think that for mm-hmm. that's for the better for all reasons, I guess. But I'm wondering about the legal system, mm-hmm. Because you know, we can philosophize or we can generalize, I guess, about, you know, how people are treated and how we hope to treat people and so forth, but I wonder what the numbers show in terms of, for instance, the number of clients you have who are Hispanic or mm-hmm. Latinx or whatever the designation, whatever designation is.
Yeah.
But, and what the, and I would bet that the numbers are very high.
They definitely are. That's not to say that we don't see a lot of variation. I mean, it's not exclusive in any way. I'm glancing as I turn my head over at my list of current clients. I would say that I've got about 1/3 Anglo, 1/3, maybe a little more than a third, maybe half English speaking, New Mexican Hispanic, and then the remainder are foreign national Spanish speaking.
And why is that?
Currently, and that's a snapshot of the current moment.
What accounts for that?
I mean, I think it's population makeup in the, it's demographics within the maybe, I mean, remember that I don't get paid by clients. So within the indigent community of New Mexico, I think that's probably a pretty fair snapshot of who makes up the indigent community.
Wouldn't that indicate to you, I mean, is it simplistic to say that that's systemic racism?
Absolutely. I mean, no questions. Systemic racism is everywhere, and it's very real. I think that the whole underpinning of that notion is, and this sort of circles back to where we were talking about before, what's the actual solution to the criminal legal system is economic opportunity. It's the isolation of poverty within generational lines and you know, barriers to climbing out of it. It's the fact that people whose parents are struggling, you know, those kids are more likely to experience adverse child experiences that increase exponentially their likelihood of system involvement.
But what about,
it's a cycle. No, that's okay. I was just, now I'm talking with my hands. It's a cycle.
That's right. I was answering your hands. No, but look, what you're describing is a little bit different than what I have in mind. I mean, you're describing mm-hmm. what are proportionate numbers given certain demographic characteristics.
But the demographic characteristics, the fact that they're indigent is that's the systemic racism. Why are they indigent? Because they are in this cycle of poverty that they can't climb out
of. Okay, great. That's a very fair point. Mm-hmm. But let me just add to it.
Sure.
That there's also police conduct. There's prosecutor conduct. There's, mm-hmm. You know, there are forces within the behavioral services profession or industry. Mm-hmm. I'm not claiming expertise on those areas. I'm just certain in my own mind that those things exist. That it's not just a matter of that we have more poor Hispanics in New Mexico. It's also, there's the way laws are enforced in the way courts enforce laws
Absolutely.
is systemically racist as well.
I think
I pose that as a
Yeah, yeah.
Possibility.
I mean, I think that has to be true. I think that we, you know, it's like we were talking earlier, we want to see, you know, everyone get the lenient sentence, not just the white guy. Yeah, that's real. And and we want to see good plea agreements for everybody, not just the white guy. And we want to see, you know, law enforcement discretion on, okay, I'm going to let you go this time, but keep your nose out of trouble or whatever. You know, we want to see that for everyone. And those sort of, where
charging
the human,
decisions.
Yeah, where the human actors in the system do have discretion, they are much less likely to exercise it with respect to minority communities, whether consciously or unconsciously based on bias and their predisposition to believing that someone who looks like you probably did something wrong.
I pose that because I guess I'm asking, you've kind of answered it, but I'm wondering if this doesn't pop out at you in your work at all. If it's something,
oh, yeah.
Something
I mean, it does all the time, of course. There's not usually anything we can do about it. Because you have to, you know, to make an equal protection claim requires a pretty significant evidentiary record that we just never get. So legally we can almost never do anything about it. Go ahead.
Oh, I guess I'm going to challenge or urge you a little bit, because I think that I've taught for many years, that decades at least, that one of the most underemphasized issues in the trial system was race. Even if you have, you know, very few people who have different races in, or different ethnicities in a particular case, you still, everybody has a race, everybody has an ethnicity, and there's always something. And it's kind of, I think, been largely under addressed nationwide, but in New Mexico also. And the way you make progress on legal issues or otherwise is by raising the issue and addressing
yeah,
the issue.
I guess what I mean to say is that on appeal, we can almost never do anything about it, because if it wasn't raised below and the evidentiary record developed in the trial court, we have nothing on appeal. So we're getting a case after that opportunity has already passed.
I'm sure you know the law better than anybody I've ever known. In fact, you kind of embarrassed me. I'm a little bit pissed off about it. Is that you? Is that every time I talk to you, you cite some cases I've never for some proposition I've never heard of? But I'm just kidding you. But no, you're very knowledgeable. I know that. I guess what I'm saying is that we have to push the envelope somewhere, and sometimes, even in appellate courts where you have standards. You know, take a risk and go, look, this doesn't look right, you know, because even if the record below was blah, blah, blah. I mean, I don't know. I guess I'm urging to push the envelope by trial lawyers and appellate lawyers, and especially on race and gender issues.
Sure.
So that's my preaching.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think we do what we can with what we have. It's not that we never raise it, and it's not that we never... I mean, I guess what I'll tell you is that on appeal, what we do more often is talk about those issues in sort of the factual section of the argument, but it's extraordinarily rare that we are actually in a position legally to include issue one, discrimination. I mean, you have,
right.
You need more of a record, and I'm just telling you this for your own edification, we need more of a record than this is a Black person to support that. I mean, there just has to be more in there.
Well, you know, Batson versus Kentucky was...
we raised Batson challenges when we were preserved.
I'm just saying, but Batson itself was raised by the client, and mm-hmm. Who said, look, this ain't right. And the lawyer said, I'm sorry, I don't mean to preach to you, Kim, but I'm just telling you what I've heard about this is that the client... The lawyer says, no, that's not the law. We can't do that. They have a right to use peremptory challenges. And the client says, well, that doesn't seem right. They strike all the Black people from the jury. And sure enough, right. They ended up with Batson versus Kentucky with Thurgood Marshall. But anyway, so I guess I'm just...
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that we should be pushing that. I guess all I'm trying to say, and I'm not trying to like kick the can or you know, say not my problem, somebody else's problem, but really, truly in this situation, we can't do anything about it on appeal if it wasn't raised below, just we can't.
Okay, so, what about the possibility of maybe you have these discussions with, when I know that you appellate gurus get together with the trial counsel on occasion, mm-hmm. and give them advice on what they need to do and so forth.
Yeah.
And perhaps they could be more sensitive. Maybe you could make them more sensitive to issues to raise to put on that record, you know. But
sure.
Anyway, like I say, it's far be it from me to teach you how to be an appellate lawyer, because I am not one. So, so I really appreciate you sharing all of your, not all of you, you've got much more wisdom, I know, to share, but you've been doing this a, you know, relatively short period of time. I mean, compared to...
Just over a decade, yeah.
Yes, compared to some of the more, let's say, mature people I've interviewed on this podcast. So I'm wondering what are your aspirations? Where are you, mm-hmm. you've done such great things in such, you know, relative short time. You've done really nice things and with organizations and with the politics and with the appellate. And I know that you have a great reputation and you do good work. So I'm wondering, where do you go from here? Are you going to go sing, or are you going to, I also happen to know you have a 2-year-old who takes quite a bit of your attention, I think, but naturally so. So,
yeah.
But what goals do you have, seriously? If you were queen, how would you proceed?
My goals right now, I'm trying not to get past maybe like 5 years ahead, because I think my whole perspective and my aspirations will be different 5 years from now. So I don't, but I would say for the next 5 years, what I would love to do is, I guess it's a stupid answer, but keep doing what I'm doing, kind of. I think I want to make as much headway as I can in legislative advocacy. I've only been in this position as appellate defender for just under 2 years. I would like to be able to sort of, I don't know, solidify my vision for this division over the next few years, and improve and increase our training and our advocacy internally to the appellate division. I would like to see what we were just talking about of, you know, the appellate, you know, sort of outreach to trial attorneys and giving them guidance on like, here's where we see the courts going and here's things we think you should be arguing. And we do that some, but again, and this is sort of a capacity and resources problem, I have a dream list that I keep running of all of the things I'm going to do when I suddenly have the time to do them. And, you know, it includes, you know, trainings for the trial attorneys on various things that we see recurring that we could maybe give them better guidance on, or outreach to the courts on various issues to improve the sort of administrative flow of cases, or better media outreach, or, you know, like there's a huge list. So
right.
I think maybe over the course of the next 5 years, I can start to tackle that list. And continue to work with as though it's going to be a new thing, but continue to work with the rest of the administration of the PDs, with the chief and deputy chiefs, et cetera, on, you know, sort of honing the mission and making the department stronger. I feel like it's an agency I believe in. And I, you know, I think as I've gotten to a place of leadership within it, I want to maximize that position as much as possible for the next, let's call it, 5 years.
Well, you're certainly a benefit to the department. You've certainly done great things and made it a better department from your work. I want to ask you thing that you said. You talked about political advocacy. Is there some, I mean, I know that being involved in that a little bit myself over the years, that there are two different schools of thought. One is to fight everything bad and go try to make sure you defeat the bad. And then there's the other side of trying to do something affirmative, which is, of course, as you and I've talked before, is infinitely harder. Takes much more to get something actually affirmatively done.
Sure.
Is there something in particular you have in goal? I mean, like years ago, you might have said repeal the death penalty or whatever, but which is a huge success, of course. But are there any particular issues you have in mind politically?
Well, I've got two things that I am actively working on now that we had bills for last session and that I hope to continue pushing. Which is the habitual offender enhancements bill we talked about a little bit earlier, and then trying to move away from incarceration on technical violations of probation and parole. So those are sort of my two big impact on incarceration projects that I'm working on actively now that I think will take a couple more years. So that is nevertheless a long-term vision. I'm also on the committee that is looking at rewriting the criminal code, which is
not. Is that going to happen? Is that really going to happen?
I mean, we're doing it. The question, what it'll actually look like, nobody knows yet. It's very early in the
process.
How
do you get input on that? I might want to come to a meeting.
Yeah, so there was a survey that circulated that I can send you that circulated to like practitioners. As well as we could circulate it, that was asking for input from every, and we got like hundreds of responses from both sides of the aisle, so to speak, the prosecutor defense aisle, and I think some judges too. And so that input will be taken under advisement. We're getting input from like think tanks around the country that have looked at these issues and from other states that have done it. Right now formulating a vision for even just scope of work. Are we going to tackle sentencing? Are we going to actually rewrite the elements of crimes? Are we doing both? What, how, you know, like,
is a Norwegian model in there somewhere? Or...
Yeah, that's a good question. I doubt it. I doubt all that's right on the table. But yeah, so that's another thing that's going to take the next 2 years. We're slated to work on that for the next 2 years. So
I'm going to ask you one bit of advice that we'll kind of slide into this, and that is, what is your advice to someone who wants to be the best appellate lawyer they can be? I mean, how do you, what are the basics or the standards for, what's the secret to having a without having to give a seminar on it,
I think that one part of it is to say it is a communications job. There is because you are presenting primarily oral argument is not it's the exception, not the rule. So generally speaking, your briefs are everything. And so your ability to say what you're trying to say in a way that the court will actually get what you're trying to say is, I think, most people's biggest challenge when they're learning this job. It was a challenge for me, certainly. Learning how to not assume what the court already knows or not overstate things in a way that loses you credibility. All of that, doing it in a written form where you don't get the benefit of hand gestures and facial expressions to get your meaning across. That I think is a big challenge for most people when they're either switching from trial work or starting out as an appellate lawyer. Obviously you have to know the law, but you're not encyclopedic. You're not expected to hold it all in your head. So there is also a part of our training, and one of the things that I can flag pretty early on if I can tell someone is probably not cut out for the gig, is being able to thoroughly research an issue and then distill it down in a way that accurately represents what the law, state of the law is. I think it's a very natural inclination for advocates to overstate or to pick the cases that sound good and ignore the rest. or to put a spin on a holding to make it sound better than it is. None of those things are advisable.
Well, so, I would imagine that just as with trial judges, that if you, as if you're constantly over there before the court, and if you
they'll just stop believing you.
If you're caught in a spin job or exaggeration or even a lie or whatever, that's disaster.
It is disaster. And then I think the moving away from sort of the technical skills involved, I think the other thing I will say is that people who are good at all of the technical things I just described, the way to actually win, our philosophy in our office is that and I mentioned this earlier, is that you have to find a way to make them care. You can't just be right on the law. They also have to care that something went wrong or what have you. So writing the factual section in a way that sets up your legal issues to matter to them is kind of the advanced level piece of it that we all then spend. Once we've gotten the basics under our belt, that's what we spend the rest of our careers honing.
Well, do you have any particular step that you think the system should and could take? I mean, other than the Norwegian model that we talked about. I mean, is there something in my practical matter that
we've been actively pushing for in a lot of conversations. I think right now what is the most important thing, especially in New Mexico, is having an alternative to the criminal system that is rooted in behavioral health and housing and economic opportunity. I think that has to be, and maybe starting probably with the behavioral health piece, because we have so much of our criminal system that is responsive to or substituting for a behavioral health system that we don't have.
All right, Kim. Mm-hmm. Well, I know that we could go on and on and on, and you've got lots of...
We could. I do have other things we should probably be doing.
You've got lots and lots of knowledge and lots of anecdotes and very interesting perspectives and very intelligent assessments. And so I appreciate you.
You're too kind.
No, I'm very serious, and I very much appreciate you spending the time with us here. Mm-hmm. And so thank you very much for being a true believer and for sharing your true beliefs with us here.
My pleasure. It was fun. Thanks for having me.
Okay, that'll be the end of this session of True Believers and the Road to Hell. Thanks a lot.